నమస్తే, వెల్కమ్ టు టీసాట్ స్పెషల్ లైవ్ షో. ఈరోజు మనం గురుకుల్ వెయిన్స్ లో భాగంగా ఆర్ట్ హిస్టరీ, ఆర్ట్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ గురించి తెలుసుకుందాం. అయితే ఆర్ట్ హిస్టరీలో సెక్షన్ 1 మొన్నటి క్లాస్ లో మనం చెప్పుకోవడం జరిగింది. ఈ రోజు సెక్షన్ 2 లోకి వెళ్దాము. అయితే వీటన్నింటి గురించి కూడా మీకు ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్ చేయడానికి అసలు క్వశ్చన్ పేపర్ ఏ విధంగా ఉండొచ్చు, అంటే ఒక గెస్ మాత్రమే క్వశ్చన్ పేపర్, అంటే ఫస్ట్ టైం జరుగుతుంది కాబట్టి ఎలా ప్రిపేర్ అవ్వాలి, ఏ ఏ పాయింట్స్ మనం మెయిన్ గా తీసుకోవచ్చు, ఇటువంటి అంశాలపై మీకు అవగాహన కలిగించడానికి మనతో ఉన్నారు సంతోష్ గారు, సబ్జెక్ట్ ఎక్స్పర్ట్. పరిచయం చేసుకుందాం. నమస్తే అండి. సో అంటే వ్యూవర్స్ కి ఫస్ట్ టైం ఇది ఎగ్జామ్ అటెంప్ట్ చేస్తున్నారు, క్వశ్చన్ పేపర్ ఖచ్చితంగా ఇలా ఉంటుందని మనము చెప్పలేము, వాళ్ళు కూడా గెస్ చేయలేరు. అయితే మొన్నటి సెక్షన్ లో మనము సెక్షన్ 1 ఆర్ట్ హిస్టరీ గురించి డిస్కస్ చేసుకున్నాము. ఈ రోజు అసలు క్వశ్చన్ పేపర్ దాదాపు మనం కొద్దిగా వాళ్ళకి గెస్ చేసి చెప్పడం ఎలా ఉంటుంది, ఎలా ప్రిపేర్ అవ్వాలి, ఏ ఏ క్వశ్చన్స్ మెయిన్ గా మనం తీసుకోవచ్చు అనేది ఓవరాల్ గా ఒకసారి వ్యూవర్స్ కోసం ఇన్ఫర్మేషన్ ఇస్తారా?
We have discussed the first section. Today we will look at the second section. In the second section, we'll only look at the art history, because art history is the largest portion, it covers the largest portion in the entire syllabus. So I will go through, if you have the question paper in front of you, you can see that I am arranging the slides, I am going through the visuals according to the categories that you have in front of you. I request you to have the question paper in front of you, like the syllabus, not the question paper, sorry, the syllabus in front of you, and we'll go as the syllabus proceeds in front of you. So in the syllabus, what you have is initially in the section of art history, you have rock cut shelters, rock art. So on the screen, you can see the dates. So in India, we have Bhimbetka is the major place, like the initial discoveries happened in Bhimbetka in Madhya Pradesh. So you can see Bhimbetka is in Madhya Pradesh. Why is it called Bhimbetka? It was called as Bhimbetak. So in the usage, it became Bhimbetka. And you can also note down the time period, 9th century BC to 7th century BC. That is the starting point. And you can have different, like you can see on the screen, you have different images. Mostly the images are of animals. The materials used are the earth colors, grounded and powdered and used, fat, blood, and the brushes are largely made out of the reeds. Okay, and apart from the earth colors, they also used blood and the natural colors that were available, and the figures were also there, but figures were very minimal, very rudimentary. They are stick-like figures, and gradually you can see in the later phases the figures also acquire some kind of a volume. Okay, so and ornamentation of animals were there. So these are the basic informations about Bhimbetka. And next is Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, the Indus Valley civilization. And in the Indus Valley civilization, you have three phases, and you can note down the dates here, the time period. Indus Valley civilization dates between 3300 BC to 1700 BC. So within that, you have three phases, early, mature, and late Harappan phase. And you can note down the years also, like the time periods also, 3300 BC to 2600, then 2600 to 1700, and 1700 to 1300, that is a late phase, and it is in the 1300 BC, people consider that the Harappan civilization and the Indus Valley civilization came to an end. Okay, so these are the basic dates, and you have some artistic examples. So for this exam, I think we can consider artistic examples as important. So this seal, the Pashupati seal, came from the Indus Valley civilization, and seals were used, as you know, we use seals now, the stamps. So seals were used for business transactions and trade largely, and these are basically small seals, and this is the most important seal that is considered from Indus Valley, the Pashupati seal. And what you have is a figure seated in the center, and you have a sort of a headgear which looks like horns, and you have animals on either side. So just a basic description. And if you go move on, you have this is another statue, like sculpture, that we found in from Indus Valley. It's a different material, low fired steatite. So you can see you already have two different materials used in Indus Valley. So this is coming from matured period and it is called Priest King. Okay, we are not going into the detailed analysis here. We are only looking at the information and what are the objects and time periods for the sake of the exam. We are not going into the analysis. If you want further detailed analysis, we already have lectures. You can look back at them on YouTube. So the next is, this is another famous sculpture called Dancing Girl, and it is done in bronze. And you can also note down the time period, 2600 to 1900 BCE. And it's a very small 2.5 to 3 inch sculpture. And we have seen three materials now, steatite, low-fired steatite, you have seen bronze, and you also have seen the plaster material, the Pashupati seal. And terracotta figurines, then this slide, terracotta figurines you have throughout the Indus Valley civilization. These are called mother goddess figurines. These are done in terracotta material, you know, clay and fired. And they were also called as votive figurines. You can remember votive offerings, votive figurines, or mother goddess figurines. Artistic examples from Indus Valley civilization. So after Indus Valley, you see the Telangana arts and crafts and icons and symbols. In the syllabus, you'll see Telangana arts and crafts, icons and symbols. And we'll briefly kind of look at few examples of Telangana arts. Cherial painting has been practiced in Warangal district, and Cherial is a place, it's a village. And this is an example of Cherial painting. You have many examples available online now, you can look at. And these were done by a community, a mendicant community, a community which travels from one place to another. And there are two things associated in this. One is the audio, another is the visual. What you see is the visual, and the artist would also sing, and that is the audio, right? So you have an audio-visual dimension to it. And Cherial painting is the play done in place Cherial, the village Cherial, which is in Warangal. And this is done on cloth used with natural colors, natural paints, and using gum arabic or gum. And yeah, about Cherial painting, it is actually a scroll painting. Nowadays you get very, you know, squarish paintings, which was not the case. These are paintings which were not supposed to be sold. These were supposed to be used for narratives. So this is Cherial painting. And in Telangana, Bidri is a very famous craft. It's from Bidar in Karnataka. Bidar is in Karnataka now. Bidar was in Hyderabad state before 1956. So which is why it is very important, or it becomes popular and important in the context of Telangana art and craft. And it is a gunmetal combination, and it is brought during the 14th century by the followers of Khaja Mohinuddin Chisti, and then it was patronized and developed by Bahmani sultans. So then it spreads from there, and it was originally from Persia, ancient Persia. And you have various kinds of objects. The slide that you see is the making. It's an inlay process. You make the object, you scoop out, and then you fill in. That is inlay process. And yeah, so the metal that is used is an alloy, which is combination of copper and zinc, and which becomes a gun metal. And then into that, silver is inlaid. So this is Bidri. And the next is another not very famous as Bidri, but very interesting, is Karimnagar filigree. The spelling is not right over there. It is Karimnagar, actually. Karimnagar is famous for filigree. And filigree is done with silver wire. So you can see here, only one single wire is used, and the entire structure, entire shape is created. So silver is the metal, and it is popular. It is made in Karimnagar in the context of Telangana. It is also made in UP and other places, but when it comes to Telangana, it is made popularly in Karimnagar. And moving to the next, Dhokra. Dhokra is a metal casting technique. largely practiced by Ojha metal smiths. They were largely in Chhattisgarh, MP, and the technique also spreads, and this we find in Adilabad, and you also have Dokra in, as I said, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, and you have West Bengal, Odisha, and Bihar also. So it's a sort of a metal practice that is largely done by a community which used to travel around, but now those communities have been settled down. So anyway, these are the basic details, and this is a casting technique. It is important because, as you saw, the filigree was not a casting technique. This is a casting technique, and the technique is called lost wax casting technique. And the metal is largely brass and a combination of brass and bronze. And the next is the famous Nirmal toys and Nirmal furniture. Nirmal is again a village in Adilabad, and Nirmal toys are made out of wood and then colored with lacquer colors. Lacquer color is made out of earth color, mixed like grounded earth color mixed with the lacquer. So you get a glaze, and these birds are very naturalistic. And after Nirmal toys, you also have Nirmal furniture from the same place. And the deck ornamentation is very important when it comes to Nirmal furniture. And you have mostly the ornamentation initially came from the Persian examples and the Mughal miniatures and the miniatures. But later we also see ornamentation coming from Ajanta also. So this is Nirmal furniture. And another important craft is the daris that exists in Hyderabad state, now in Telangana, which is Warangal daris. Warangal is the important place where these daris and carpets are made out of jute, cotton, and wool. And this again has links with Persia and Iran particularly, and because these, that may be Nirmal, that may be Bidri, filigree, and these actually came during the late medieval time when the Islamic, you know, rulers' influence and, you know, the culture traveled from Persia and Iran to the Deccan. So this was because of which you can see these daris becomes very important, and also the geometric patterns that you see, they also come from the Persian and the Iranian influence. So moving on to the other textiles, you know, Pochampalli is very important for ikat. This is ikat. And you have Narainpet. Narainpet, you have very beautiful saris, both of silk and cotton. And Narainpet's saris are famous for their borders, particularly the zari border and the vibrant colors. And now, after a few number of crafts that we have seen, arts and crafts, the Telangana government recently has announced the symbols of Telangana state. So you have this blue jay, which is called Palapitta. These were announced in 2015, and you can just note down. I'm sure by now you know all these. It's in the popular knowledge. So this is one, and they all have some kind of a link with the mythology. So this is spotted this is spotted before invading Lanka, so it has a link with Ramayana. So, and Rama got victory over Ravana, so this is considered auspicious and lucky, so which is why it is the state bird. Deer is the state animal. Deer also has a link with Ramayana, I'm sure we all know. I'm not going to elaborate on it. So deer is the state animal, and this the tree Jambichattu is the state tree. Again, it has the story, the link with the narrative of victory, where, you know, the Pandavas, you know, kept their armory, and then they came back from the exile and they took the armory, their weapons, and they sort of worshipped the tree at that point of time, and they got victory. So this also has an association with victory, Jambichattu. And then Thangedu flower is, we all know that this is very much used in most of the festivals in Telangana. So this is the state flower. So we have these four symbols, and this is the state symbol, the state administrative and political symbol. This is designed by Lakshman Ele, and you can see you have a Kakatiya Torana, and you have the three lion head of Indian state, and then you have Charminar. So this, I'm sure we all remember this. This is the Martyrs Memorial, Telangana Martyrs Memorial, done in 1975 by Ekka Yadgiri Rao, the sculptor. And this stands right in front of the assembly. So after this section, you will see some names are given, like Leonardo, Michelangelo, and we'll see those names of the artists and their basic information. Leonardo da Vinci was born in Florence, and he was born in 1452, so 15th century, the mid 15th century. And Vitruvian Man, this is the drawing that you see, which is called Vitruvian Man. Vitruvian Man, or the Universal Man. This is a drawing done by Leonardo. Leonardo is famous for two paintings. He has done many paintings, but the most famous paintings are two, which I'm showing you. Last Supper, this is the Last Supper. It's a fresco, and you can note down the time period and as well as where it is done. Santa Maria delle Grazie in Milan, and this is done in a refectory, so where food is being served. So anyway, this is Last Supper by Leonardo da Vinci, and done in fresco and in Milan. So this is the basic information. And Mona Lisa is another famous painting by Leonardo. And Mona Lisa is considered to be more mysterious. There has been a lot of investment by the art historians, and many kinds of efforts have been made to understand what it is. So this is an oil painting, oil on wood, and it is done in 1505. It's a later painting in the career of Leonardo. And yeah, so the technique, I just want to give you a few details about it. What is Mona Lisa? Basically, Mona Lisa means, Mona means the short form of My Lady, that is Madonna, which is Mona, and Lisa is the Lisa, the name of the wife of the person who actually, the wealthy Florentine who actually patronized this, Francisco del, you can spell that now, Giocondo, right? Francisco del Giocondo, a Florentine wealthy merchant, and it is his wife's painting. So Mona Lisa is the wife of this guy, and yeah, so Mona, you know, now Mona is the short form of Madonna, and Lisa is the name. The name comes from, you can see on the first line, Lisa di Antonio. So comes from Lisa. So that is that, and convincing likeness, personality, and it's a very new kind of a portrait painting. Again, portrait painting starts during this time, during Renaissance. And sfumato is the technique. Sfumato is this soft, mysterious technique that Leonardo has invented. And chiaroscuro is the light and shade. Chiaroscuro, obscure. Obscure is shade. Light and shade is the combination for chiaroscuro. And atmospheric perspective. So these are things are these things are combined in this particular painting, as you can see. And you have a window into landscape. So these are the basic points if you want an elaboration on Mona Lisa. And the mysterious smile, as we know, is very popular. And you can also note the point of the hand gesture, right? And also the light. So, but anyway, for the sake of exam, the basic details are enough. And the other artist is Michelangelo, and he's also famous, we all know. And he comes a little later than Leonardo, born in 1475, the late 15th century. And Sistine Chapel is the most famous work that he did, most famous painterly work. He is both painter as well as sculptor, and he was also an architect. But we'll see only painting and sculpture today. This is Sistine Chapel. He painted the entire ceiling with Old Testament scenes. And it is commissioned by Julius II, the Pope Julius II, in 1508. And you can see here one of the example, one of the fragment of the ceiling, which is the creation of Adam by the God. So this is the basic information. And he also painted Last Judgment in the Sistine Chapel in the main wall, not the ceiling. Ceiling is filled with the Old Testament stories. So other work by Michelangelo is this sculpture, which is called Pietà. And it is famous for this, the emotion that it shows. And the young lady that you see, young Madonna, Mary, Virgin Mary, but she is very young. She doesn't look like a mother. So these are points one can keep in mind. And this is done in marble and very well carved, deep cut marble. And the next sculpture is David. This is also a very famous sculpture by Michelangelo, done little later, 1501. And this is a different gold, David than Donatello and then later Bernini. So these are basic information. This is about Goliath. He's waiting for Goliath, as if. So after, you will see after Michelangelo, you have Van Gogh as the name. Van Gogh was born in 1885. And this is one of the paintings, one of the early paintings by Van Gogh called Potato Eaters. It's a very famous sort of a painting in the early time, early part of his career. Van Gogh was a Dutch. He was born in Netherlands. As you can see here, you have more details. Born in 1853. In Zundert in southern Netherlands. Okay, and he is an artist of post-impressionism. You can keep that also in mind, post-impressionism. And yeah, next, this is another sort of prominent painting by Van Gogh called The Bedroom. And you have two chairs. This is in anticipation of Gauguin's visit. I'm not going into detail, but you can just remember the objects if you want. And this is the most famous painting by Van Gogh called Starry Night. There's also a song called Starry, Starry Night. So this is this song was inspired after this. And this he painted when he was in the asylum in Saint-Rémy Asylum. This is one of the later paintings, Starry Night. I'm not going into the analysis of the image. We'll just stick to the information. So another name that you see is Salvador Dali. Dali was a surrealist painter. He was a Spanish, born in Catalonia in 1904. Right. So this is the basic information. And the painting that you see is Soft Construction with Boiled Beans. So surrealism deals with dream. So you can keep that in mind. Surrealism deals with psychic realism, psyche or psychology. And this is the most famous painting of Dali called The Persistence of Memory, right? So he painted after a dream, basically. So surrealism is linked with dreams. So these are the basic details about surrealism. And the other artist you see is Picasso, Pablo Picasso. This is the most famous painting of Picasso. And he's also considered to be the inventor of cubism. When you hear cubism, it is Picasso who comes to your mind. And this is the painting called Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, painted in 1907. This is the first painting which led to the invention of cubism. So you can keep this in mind. This is about the brothel and about the prostitutes, if you want more information, that he saw in the street of Avignon. And this is the painting which led to the technique called collage. This is again, a very important painting when it comes to modern art, Still Life with Chair Caning in 1912. From this onwards, you have synthetic cubism starting. So when it comes to cubism, you have two phases of cubism, which is the analytical cubism and synthetic cubism. So these are the two important works. And this is the painting by Picasso. Again, this is called Guernica. And this is the one of the popular paintings that he painted in 1937. It's a mural, and it is he painted after the bombing, actually, when Nazi was bombing casually Guernica is a city, actually. So they bombed Guernica when the Spanish Civil War was going. So Picasso painted it as a response. So Guernica, painted by Picasso in 1937. So after that, you'll see Ravi Verma. Ravi Verma was born in the princely state of Travancore. And he belonged to a very educated sort of a parenthood. And yeah, so he's considered to be the first artist, individual artist of India, of Indian modern art. And he painted images of gods and goddesses. And this is one example that you see. He was invited by Baroda Maharaja, and he stayed there, and he painted several of these over there. So 10 paintings of Indian goddesses over there. So he painted Indian gods and goddesses extensively, as well as the mythological stories. This is the example of mythological story. You know this, the it's coming from Ramayana. So after that, you'll see Maqbul Firdaus Hussain, MF Hussain, in your list, born in 1915 in Pandharpur, Maharashtra. Right. So I'm not going into further details. So he reached Mumbai in 1937, and he basically started as a billboard painter. He used to paint cinema posters, and then later he starts enters art practice. So this is one example of his work. It's a famous painting between the spider and the lamp. And then this is a most this is the controversial painting, Bharat Mata, and you know there was a controversy around this, how by the right wing forces, if you remember. And we'll move to the next artist. So we'll see a bunch of Hyderabad artists from modern artists from Hyderabad. This is P.T. Reddy. P.T. Reddy was born in Hyderabad, and then he went to Bombay. He studied in JJ School of Art, then he came back to Hyderabad. So this is one example of his painting, and this is another example of his painting, which is very different. So he worked in different mediums. He also was associated with Lalit Kala Academy, the AP Lalit Kala Academy, as well as the Hyderabad Art Society. So these are informations that you can keep in mind. And Rajaya was born in Siddipet, Medak, and he studied in the Fine Arts College, the College of Fine Arts in Hyderabad. And then later he established something called the Lalit Kala Samiti in Siddipet, which is active still. So he is the folk painter. He's not the folk painter, but he was influenced by the folk art. So he's one of the early artists of Hyderabad who was influenced by folk language of painting. So this is one example. This is another example. So he painted the culture and the tradition of the region that he was living in, which is the Telangana region. So this is the example where of Batukamma, and you can see the folkish sort of an idiom in his paintings. And Seshagiri Rao. He also studied in the College of Fine Arts in Hyderabad. Then he went to Shantiniketan, and he returned from there, and he started teaching in the same art school where he studied. He considered himself as a traditional painter. He was born in Warangal, then he came to Hyderabad to become an artist. So this is an example. So he also painted extensively. Not the folk much, but he painted the mythological stories. So which is why he considered himself as a traditional painter. He's also a painter who worked extensively in the Chinese technique. So that is also a point you can keep in mind, a Chinese calligraphic technique. So this is an example of his painting. This is another example. He was a versatile artist of who could paint anything very easily. So this is another. And this is another example where you can see this is more about, this is not about mythology, but this is about the tribal and the folk people. One of the most popular artists is Vaikuntham, T. Vaikuntham. He was born in 42. He started off late, studied in the same art school, College of Fine Arts. Then he went to Baroda in the 60s for 1 year to study there under one guru in Baroda, MS University Fine Arts Department. Then he comes back, then he starts working, and he was also invited by Narsingh Rao, B. Narsingh Rao, the filmmaker, when he was making Ma Bhumi. So Vaikuntham worked as an art director for Ma Bhumi and other such films made by Narsingh Rao. So he was very much influenced by the folk, rural, and the rustic imagery and the people. So this is an example. And he grows into this kind of a ornamentation, kind of ornamental, colorful paintings. And this is another example of his painting. And Surya Prakash is another artist of Hyderabad who again studied in the same art school. And he came from Khammam, and he extensively works with the landscape. He's a very different kind of with a different temperament than other artists of Hyderabad. He works with nature, and he works in the L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. He has a studio there. Just for the sake of information, you can keep in mind. This is the kind of work. So another artist is Padma Shri Lakshma Gowd. Again, he also studied in the same art school, the College of Fine Arts, Hyderabad. Then he went to Baroda. Then he studied mural over there. Then he came back and he started practicing. So he established SN School, the Fine Arts Department in the SN School of Arts and Communication in Hyderabad University. He's one of the pioneering printmakers of India and particularly Hyderabad. He's from Medak again, and a very important printmaker. He also worked with the tradition, the local flavor, and the local imagery. So you can see this is an example of the local imagery. And now you can see we can move to this Ajanta and Ellora later. Ajanta, you can keep this in mind, 2nd century BC to 6th century AD or CE. And largely it was done under Wakataka kings, and Harisena was an important king whose patronage is very important for this site. And you have two basic architectures over there. One is Chaitya, which is a prayer hall. Another is Vihara, which is like a hostel. So this is Chaitya, where you have the stupa image in the center and you can go prayer. And this is Vihara, which is nothing but for the monks to stay inside. So you have small rooms and small stone beds and stone pillows inside. Very interesting. And you have very important paintings coming from there, the Jataka stories, the life stories of Buddha. And I'm showing you two important images. One is Padmapani Bodhisattva, which is the lotus bearer, you can see here, and the Vajrapani Bodhisattva, the thunderbolt bearer. So two paintings from there. And the Ellora caves, you see, they were built by Rashtrakutas, so between 6th and to 10th century AD. This is later. So you have 12 Buddhist caves, 12 Hindu caves, 5 Jaina caves, right? So this is one of the examples of Brahminical caves, the Hindu caves, cave number 14, and the sculpture also, example of sculpture of Nataraja. And this is another example of Varaha Avatara, the Vishnu Varaha Avatara. So you have ample sculptures in Ellora, particularly of Brahminical faith. And Kailashnath temple, the cave number 16, is a very famous temple, and it is world famous. It is also notified by UNESCO, and it was possibly built in 8th century AD. It's a very complex architecture. We're not going into detail, but 8th century, and yeah, it's a stone architecture. It's a monolith, entirely carved out of stone. It is not a constructed temple. It's a carved out temple. And we'll look at the miniature finally. You have different schools of miniature, Jain, Mughal, Deccan, Central India, Rajasthani, and Pahadi. So Jain comes quite earlier. So Jain miniatures are largely related with Kalakacharya Katha and Kalpasutra, which are basically Jain stories. So those are two. And the Mughal miniatures are very famous. They are really, they have contributed a lot to the image of Indian painting. So this is Hamza Nama. Hamza Nama is one of the most famous, the folio, the album emerged from Mughal painting. So this is an example. This is another example, the Jahangir shooting Malikambar. It is a later painting. And moving to Rajasthani school, you have different schools within Rajasthan. You can note down Mewar, Bikaner, Bundi, Kota, Kishangarh, Rajhurgarh. And you have various other small places also. So, but these are the basic and major places. So this is from Mewar. And remember, most of the Rajasthani as well as Pahadi paintings were based on the mythological stories, the images of gods and goddesses, and largely Krishna plays a very important role. Okay, the stories of Krishna is very important, as well as Mahabharata and Ramayana. So as you know, Krishna's story is attached with Mahabharata, and yeah, so largely these two epics and the images of gods and goddesses, and you have the stories, largely these are the narrative stories of the life, the Leelas or Krishna Leela. And but these are based on some texts that were written at that point of time. So these are basic informations. So, and they're very colorful. They are done in gouache technique with watercolors and on paper. This is called Bani Thani. Bani Thani is a style which is associated with Kishangarh in Rajasthan. And this is from Kota. As you can see, these are all related to the mythological stories. Now the Pahari school, Pahari school is nothing but, you know, Himachal Pradesh, Uttaranchal, Jammu and Punjab, those, that region. And you have different small places within Pahari school, and these places are basically the places of the names, names of the places, and that becomes the school actually. The painting produced from Kangra becomes the Kangra painting, like that. So Kangra, Basoli, Guler, Chamba, Garhwal, Nurpur, Mandi, and you have Kulu. You also have Punjab painting. You have Jammu, and you have Himachali hills. So various other also categories are also there. But these are the major popular categories. And this is an example from Garhwal, Tehri Garhwal. So you can see this is again about Krishna and Gita Govinda, and you know Krishna and Krishna Leela with gopis and the romantic stories of Krishna and in the landscape. So all these miniatures, what they do is they show the local landscape. So you can see different miniature shows their own particular landscape from which it is painted. So Kangra will be a different landscape than, let's say, Garhwal. And this is Guler. This is a different effect altogether. You have the yellow here, and this is a lady playing a musical instrument. This could be Meera, we don't know. And you can also remember, keep in mind at this point of time, is this is the time of Bhakti movement, where the Krishna, the Vaishnava and the Shaivism and the Vaishnavism was very popular. So when it comes to Vaishnavism, the image of Krishna becomes very popular. So this is an example from Himachal Pradesh, Mandi, Ganga, the goddess Ganga. Basholi is very important for its background. As you can see, the background is flat yellow, and the bright yellow, which is called Indian yellow, and this is the characteristic of Basholi from Pahari painting. And the last school that we'll see is Dakkani school, where we are now, Dakkan, right? It emerged around the late 16th century, and you have various other influences coming into Dakkan at that point of time. Dakkani school is a combination of different influences. The North Indian influences from, let's say, Rajasthan, as well as the Mughal influence, and you also have Iran influence from the Persian regions. So the characteristics are elongated figures, high horizons, and floral springed backgrounds, different from, let us say, Mughal painting. And the important places are Bijapur, Ahmednagar, Golconda, Aurangabad, and Hyderabad. So these are the places where miniature painting had been happening. And this is an example. This is the famous painting. This is one of the most famous paintings when we look at Dakkani school. This is done, this is from Bijapur, called Yogini with Maina. And you can see a lot of Persian elements in this, as well as the local treatment, early 17th century. And it is opaque color, and gold leaf is also used. You can see the figure is elongated, and you can see the floral ornamentation, the nature around, but the nature is painted in a sort of an ornamental treatment. And you have in the horizon, you have a sort of an architecture, a sort of a temple, the white architecture. So this, the perspective is again shows that as if it is coming from the Mughal influence. So this is Golconda. Dancing girl from Golconda. And so you also have some influences from the Thanjavur. The way you can see here, the gold is used. This you don't see in the northern part of India, that may be Mughal painting or Rajasthani or Pahari. It's only used in this region most visibly. So this could be coming from the Tanjavur tradition of painting. And this is, you have many folios produced. So miniatures were not painted like one single painting, they were painted in folios. So this is one of the folios, and this is a painting called Breads and Sweets, Naan Va Halwa. So this is about a moral story basically, but anyway, let's not go into the story. This is painted in Aurangabad, and you see this also has a link with the British here. You can see the wig, wigged man, the man with wig in the frame, and you have the saint feeding dog. So this has a moral story about the living. So we have seen a range of like the questions that come, but we missed two which are difficult to kind of discuss: the contemporary art of India as well as the European art and artists. So that you can see what all you can count and what all you can prepare. The contemporary art of India, you can see different artists from progressive artist group to later post-independence group, post-independent artists. So you can name, you can have names, and then you can just take down the basic information about them. And the European art and art artists, we have discussed in the lectures different kinds of art movements. You can fall back on them, but also you can have your own list of these artists. So it's, so we have had, like, we have discussed a basic sort of a information in relation to the possible questions that might come tomorrow. We are just guessing. This is just a guessing exercise. We don't really know what kind of questions, but the questions are going to be, they should be basic. They are not going to be extremely complicated. So I hope you do well in your exams, and a very good luck to you all. Thank you.
సో సంతోష్ గారు ఆర్ట్ హిస్టరీలో సెకండ్ సెక్షన్ గురించి చెప్పారు, అలాగే రకరకాల అంటే సెంచురీస్ నుంచి పెయింటింగ్ ఎలా వస్తుంది, టెక్నిక్స్ ఏంటి, ఎలా ప్రిపేర్ అవ్వాలి, వీటన్నిటి గురించి కూడా చాలా చక్కగా ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్ చేసినందుకు థ్యాంక్ యూ సో మచ్. ఇది ఇవాళ టీ సాట్ స్పెషల్ లైవ్ షో. కీప్ వాచింగ్ టీ సాట్.